Hello, everyone. I'm Don Singh of Marpin News. It's a beautiful day in Portsmouth. Blue skies, not a lot of cloud cover. A wonderful day, but still a sad one. We're here to cover the passing of Rosie Douglas, the church service, and his burial. I'm actually at the Arbedee Cinema, the initials of Rosie Douglas and his father. This is where the Prime Minister is lying in state for the final time. I've made some notes about the passing of Rosie Douglas, which I'd share with you. To me, it is many faceted. The people of Portsmouth here have lost a parliamentary representative, as well as a native son. The children have lost a father. The siblings have had a brother taken from them. The Caribbean, the carriage, black people, and all those who suffer wrong are weaker today for his passing. Dominica has been deprived of a prime minister just a few months into office. But this is not the end in some ways, because you might say that Rosie Douglas goes on to join his father and his brother, who have gone ahead of him. Standing with me as part of this broadcast is Sylvester Cadette, telecoms advisor with the government, and a man who worked very closely with the late prime minister, especially in his last days in office. Sylvester, here we are standing next to the casket bearing the prime minister. It's a very sad time, and we are really standing on privileged ground. What are your thoughts at this time?
Well, first of all, I think it's a day that would be etched in the minds of Dominique, and it is a great loss, a stalwart has gone, and I am sure that the memory of the late Rosie Douglas would live on in the minds not only of Dominicans, but also the wider region and on the international scene. It's a very, very solemn occasion, and as we go on through the course of the day, we would definitely observe those situations that would definitely testify to Mr. Douglas's his activities in Portsmouth, in Dominica, and we just hope that Dominicans would come to terms with such a loss, though it's a great loss. We do hope that they'll come to terms with it.
You know, Sylvester, we will always have to talk about what his contributions have been and will continue to be, even though he's gone. And from your perspective of having worked with him on a daily basis, how do you put that in perspective for yourself?
In terms of his day-to-day activities, the little I've seen of him, and especially in the last couple of months, he was one who had a vision. I consider him a visionary, one who had a clear-cut vision for Dominica. And I can say safely, in the sector in which I operate and work, he really wanted to see information technology move forward. He wanted to see the telecom sector develop, to infuse the Dominican economy with what it would necessarily take to move forward. So he had a lot of thoughts in mind, and he had the country close at heart. And it is one of the greatest losses we would have in recent times as far as a leader is concerned.
Overhead on the verandas at street level, and there are barricades around the cinema, And people standing there just observing what's happening. We have been privileged to have been able to come through the barriers and to go to where the late Prime Minister is still lying in state. And we saw members of his family paying their last respects. The only question that comes to me is, what are your thoughts at this time?
Very moving moment. It's almost an emotionally difficult time for me. I'd come to know the late Prime Minister for several years. In fact, we sat on the benches of the Parliament for almost 10 years together. I just left Parliament in January of this year. We were in the opposition together between the period 1995 to 2000. And I'd worked with him in several different areas, strategizing, political strategies in Parliament, how to deal with the government, and so on. And the man of tremendous character. I mean, I reflected coming on the flight last night into Dominica, and I said, Dominica has lost a tremendous individual, someone who has contributed a lot to the overall development of the country. I mean, not necessarily in the big physical infrastructural things, but you know, when you talk to people and the little things he was doing, and they all add up. It's quite a number of things. And
may I make an observation? Perhaps
it's difficult to make sure.
Perhaps one, is it fair to say that his contribution as a leader to Dominica began long before he was Prime Minister?
I think that's a beautiful way of putting it. The late Prime Minister, Douglas, contributed selflessly to this country. Over a long period of time, he sent several Dominicans, hundreds of Dominicans, to study in Cuba. He championed the cause of black people regionally and internationally. He established tremendous contacts regionally and internationally as well. And that was done while he was in opposition. And a lot of that was done even before he was in Parliament too as well. So he developed for himself a tremendous reputation. 8 months as Prime Minister isn't much to really judge him by, because he was just beginning to kind of get his feet wet, so to speak, in government. But obviously what he has done, when you put the whole track record together, prior to parliamentary life, during parliamentary life, thirdly as Prime Minister, when you put that story together, that package together, I don't think there are many persons who can match that. He has made a tremendous contribution to this country. I think we all should recognize it. We should put our political hats down. We should really call a spade and speak the truth. And a number of us sometimes wait till someone passes on to really see it all. But I think this is a man who was magnanimous in his thinking, very open-minded, who held no grudges. I say more for it in the Parliament. I never saw Roosie, if I should put it this way, got upset, got vexed with anybody, you know, arrogant in any way. That was not his personality. Cool, even under the pressure, the heat of it all, the fire in Parliament, he always kept his cool. Tremendous individual.
So that is a rare, that's a rare quality in people, isn't it? Do you think now that his work will be carried on, or do you think there will be a hiatus?
I think we should try to carry on his work. I don't know if any one individual can do it. I think Roosie represented several individuals, so to speak. I mean, he was a man of tremendous capacity. And I don't think there's any one particular individual who can sit in his shoes competently. We all have to come together as a country and realize, listen, I mean, we passed through this life once. Why the enmity? Why the fuss? Let's pull our resources together. This is a small country, small in terms of population size, in terms of geography, in terms of economic and you know, availability, if I could use that word. And I think we should come together and try to, if not emulate, but try to follow up from where Roosie left off, the former Prime Minister left off, so that if anything, at least, you know, we would be doing quite a bit to further the development of this country, because undoubtedly he has done a lot to bring this country to the level of development which it is at this present point in time.
So thank you very much for talking to us at this sad moment, for you personally and of course for the country.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Mr. Singh, as we were speaking, I've been noticing that the music lovers government band is now filtering through, and I guess it might just be the time that the whole procession would begin. We begin to see a very large crowd here beginning to develop under very bright skies, and we anticipate that there would be a crowd that has never been seen in Dominica in Portsmouth. People coming to pay their last respects. And it's very moving.
And there's a dignity about it, don't you agree?
Well, yes, indeed. Mr. Douglas was a dignified man, and he carried out his work in a dignified manner, one who really assiduously pioneered and laid a foundation upon which he hoped Dominica's meritocracy would build a deeper pinnacle of sapience. And that was his dream, that there would be a unifying force in the community where he was and where he represented, as well as Dominica on a whole. So that is going to be a moving moment for all Dominicans today.
I'm now going to have a little chat with Peter Griffiths, the managing director of the Lyndhurst Funeral Home, which is taking care of all of the funeral arrangements for Rosie Douglas. Peter, I've known you for so many years, we don't need to talk about that part of it, but would you give us some insight into, perhaps let's just start with the casket. Is it a special casket that the Prime Minister lies in now?
Yes, it's a solid wood mahogany casket. It is lined with velvet, and it is designed in such a way, as you notice, there's no head and foot handles, so that it can be used quite easily for the official state bearer to carry. It is a Canadian-made manufactured casket.
Now the job you've had, for the want of a better word right now, what does it mean to you personally? Because throughout your life, you have been involved, I know, with very important people in situations like this. What does this particular burial mean to you?
Well, of course, he's the Prime Minister of Dominica, and it is important that to Lyndhurst and to myself that Lyndhurst has been entrusted with the arrangement. Of course, we have worked in other countries, Guyana, the late Portsmouth, and he also buried his brother here, Rosie, and Michael, and in St. Lucia, Sir Arthur Lewis. So we are no strangers, really, to the arrangements of state funerals. But the Prime Minister is always a special situation.
Has it gone according to plan, as far as you're concerned?
Yes, I think that the arrangements have gone quite smoothly so far, and I see no reason why it shouldn't continue. The police has done an excellent job. The committee, I think, has planned quite well, and I compliment all of them.
Thank you very much, Peter. Gabriel Christian.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir. I just talked to Peter Griffiths. I'm still standing here with Sylvester Cadette, who is contributing to the broadcast, and we are talking to people who are in front of the cinema, where the Rosie Douglas is still lying in state until he's taken to the church, which is not far from here. With us is Gabriel Christian, a very tall man, as will be obvious from
you're
the...
You're very distinct,
thank you. For those of you who might remember the live broadcast on the day the Prime Minister died, Sunday, I spoke to Mr. Christian from Washington. He was one of the people we spoke to, and he's here in Dominica, and it's a pleasure for me to see him in person and to meet him for the first time. I've asked a number of people, Gabriel, a simple question. What are your thoughts at this time?
Well, first of all, Don, good morning to you and good morning to your listeners. Good morning to the bereaved family and all bereaved and distracted nation. My thoughts at this time focus on vision, hard work to implement that vision. That's what our dearly beloved Prime Minister fought hard for. What he died for. He died at his station, executing the best he could on the vision that he had. I'll just say that this morning I've been running around a little bit trying to place the flag party immediately behind the caisson or the hearse. That's the flag party of the Dominican Cadet Corps. The The first unit of which Dominica Grammar School Cadet Corps was founded in 1910. That corps had been dormant for 22 years. Once independence took place, government did not see fit to fund that portion of youth development. And we hear all people talk about the young people as being sometimes shiftless and indisciplined, but you can't reap fruits where you have not sown the seed. And so in 8 months, I, Mr. Roosevelt Douglas, my brother and friend and mentor and leader, made it part of his mission to resuscitate the Corps, to be at the cutting edge of development. And they were at the Presidential House on Thursday. They were at Grand Bay yesterday. In 3 days, these grammar school students and these Portsmouth secondary school students who had not even been trained, who had just been given their uniforms Wednesday evening, executed on that vision so remarkably that seasoned the police officers, including the commissioner of police, who had been police officers for 25, almost 30 years, were amazed. They were amazed how, when the crowd surged forth to Grand Bay in their passion and love for our leader, they held them back. When the rains came down to give us blessings, they stood there and took it. And I was there in my little blazer, and, you know, I was going to head for the cover. But when I saw the kids taking the rain and standing without having been told, I thought I would have not been doing us any service or justice by doing anything else but standing and taking it with them. They're here today, and they make us all as Dominicans proud and tell us what our young people can do. And that, again, as I said, was part of that vision that the Prime Minister in 8 months was able to execute upon, including many others. And so while today is a sad and bitter moment for me, so it's 20 years ago that I spoke from the porch of the Douglas Guest House at an election, the only election that I had a chance to vote in, the 1980 election. Of course, I voted for the party that's lost, but we never lost the spirit. We're here, and we're going to continue forth. The cadets are here, they're going to continue forth. The Dominicans are here, of all parties, of all classes, all ethnic origins, our friends from all over the world are here. And so he's opened the door to us. It's now left to us who are left behind to carry on and carry forward that vision and to implement with dispatch the things which we so dearly wanted for our beloved country.
Thank you, Gabriel. We'll be in touch before you go. Thank you, sir. Sylvester, you've heard a very impassioned description of Mr. Douglas's commitment to young people.
Well, in fact, it could not have been better said. He was one who really championed the cause of young people. And this was exemplified in his, there's a testament to that in his trying to ensure that many young Dominicans had an education, who could have gone through the portals of institutions of higher learning. And many of them are now back here serving in Parliament, serving in areas that are of repute. And this is testament to Mr. Douglas's work. And that was one of his lifelong dreams, that the Cadet Corps would have been revitalized, and this year revitalized, re-energized a unit.
The crowd hasn't really gotten much larger, but it remains as quiet and as dignified as you said it was from the beginning.
People are still milling around, and once they would hear the first sound of the band and the echo of the military command, then most likely we would see an influx of people coming into that particular square, the Borough Square. It is one area that is that could just typify the life of Douglas, of the late Prime Minister.
As I look around, Alex, if you shoot the camera up that way, there's some people at the highest vantage point that this area affords, and there are people, as I say, on the verandas, on the sidewalks, just standing in the street waiting for the special moment. And in fact, from here, the Prime Minister's body will be taken to the church for the funeral service, and from there to Hampstead.
I know it's going to be very tough for many individuals, because these were the areas that they frequented when Mr. Douglas was in Dominica, and especially after coming into Parliament in the 80s, these were the areas where people found comfort. Along these streets and going down to his home, these were the areas that people trod. discussing with him, getting comfort, getting assistance. And as he would leave this series, the Arbedee Cinema, and move on to the church, I think it would definitely be overwhelming. And I guess we'd all have to brace ourselves for that.
Well, with the help of God, we will see it through, Sylvester. I'm standing now with Sean Douglas. I met Sean several weeks ago when he came with his uncle, the late Prime Minister, to Marpin Television Studios. The Prime Minister was going to brief us on one of his last visits overseas, and I met the Prime Minister for the first time, was impressed at how tall he was, met Sean. And Sean, I am very sorry to see you again under these circumstances.
Yeah, I remember when I came, you invited me to come, you know, come back to Marpin, you know. Yeah, I watched that interview. Rosie was in a blue suit. He had just had a haircut in Taiwan. His hair was short. He looked very well, you know. And after that, I must have seen him maybe two times, and that was it really.
You know, the strange thing for me, which I will tell you, is when I saw him then, I obviously never thought it'd be the last time I'd see him. It was just a simple story about my encounter with the Prime Minister. You have spent so many years of your life with him, so I don't know how you deal with that, you know?
Well, like I've said many times before, Rosie really was more than an uncle to me. He was somebody who my early political education, from the time I was about 9, he came back to Dominica from Canada, really. He introduced me to politics, and as a young boy growing up, I always said that when I grew up, if I could think like Rosie and speak like Mike, then, you know, I would do very well. And I hope that from the two of them, that somehow I've picked up, I've learned something from them, because they had a tremendous impact on my life, and an impact that will live with me in the memory for a long, long time. I think it will take, I don't know how long it will take, probably years, I might even need counseling, because it's such a void that has been left, and I don't know what's going to fill it. I mean, if I were married, maybe children, I would have somewhere to channel my energies. At the moment I don't, so you know, it will take, the healing process will take much longer than it really ought to. I have to somehow pick up the pieces and get up and dust myself and move on. But how do you do that really when somebody who has such a huge impact on your life from 7, 8, 9 up to through adolescence, late teenage years, late 20s and 30, you know, it was, as I say, 24 years, you know, my entire childhood and adulthood really.
John, yes?
I have known Sean Douglas from our days at St. Mary's Academy. And it's really short in time. We met once during the course of this year when he returned from England. And one of the things I really wanted to find out is how would that impact on you from a political perspective, his legacy, because he has left a legacy that will definitely live on.
Rosie, really, I don't know, because you see, there was no, he didn't really groom any successor, really, you know. Many of the trips he went on, really, he went by himself, you know, so a lot of the contacts, you know, very few people really know them. I suppose you could find out, but I'm prepared to really, myself and the other people, like I suppose my other cousin Ken, who spent the last 8 months with him, and there are many people I know in London who organize most of his meetings, especially in the Scandinavian countries. I know some of his friends in Liberia. He has a very good friend, Charles Taylor, in Liberia. I know, for example, his contacts in Sinn Féin in Ireland. I know some of his contacts with the Libyans. I tell you, we have to really sit down and really think, because it's going to be difficult, because, as I said, he didn't really groom anybody. There was, you know, and, you know, really to take on that mantle. It's going to be very difficult, but as I say, you know, new leaders emerged when Maurice Bishop was assassinated in 1983. Many people felt, well, Grenada couldn't recover. I suppose it did, or it has to a certain extent. With Rosie, really, I think it'll maybe take maybe a good, it'll probably set Dominica back, or maybe about 20 years. I hope not, I hope not, because Dominica already, we can't go any further back. Rosie, as I said last night, wouldn't want us to sit and mourn. He wants us to have a futuristic outlook, be positive. We wanted to transform Dominica from a low-income, low-skilled, low-productivity economy to a high-skilled, high-income, high-productivity economy. And the only way we could do that, he felt, was moving from an agrarian revolution to an information technology revolution, moving from agriculture to informatics to telecommunications, computers. You know, he really believed in that passionately. He felt Dominica had to break out of the development paradigm we followed for the last 30 years and more. And he felt Dominicans deserved a high standard of living. That is why he urged people, since 92, he spoke about this strategic alliance he wanted to forge with God, with Martinique and with France. And at first I felt it was a balmy idea. But I began to think about it. I said, listen, you know, we share a common history, a common geography, a common culture with the people of Guadeloupe and Martinique. You have 1 million people between the two countries. We're between this high-income zone. Dominica served as a base for free French forces when Hitler overran France, when the Vichy regime were in charge. So we have a shared history. And, you know, his vision, we have to build on that. You know, he left us a lot. He didn't, you know, he took us to the gates of the promised land. He had the key in his hand. He couldn't quite open the door. He fell, he died just at that juncture. But he's left us enough for us to really build. His entire life really was one of struggle, one of sacrifice, you know, sacrifice at the expense of his family, at the expense of himself. When he started sending students to Cuba, to Austria, to the Ukraine, Czechoslovakia, all these countries, people felt, oh, these are communist countries, that Dominican students won't go to church, you know. Now we see, we go to the hospital in Roseau, and we see Dominican doctors, qualified, skilled, like anybody qualified in Europe or North America. So he had this vision that, you know, that Dominicans had to, because Dominica 20 years ago, he had about 5 or 6 doctors, mainly the Dr. McIntyre and Dr. Winston's, and now you've got ordinary people from all over, all parts of Dominica, 4 people really, who have sent it to Cuba, and they're now qualified Dominicans making the contribution. That is a legacy of people like Rosie and other people.
Indeed, he was a political colossus, and one who really had the country at heart, and like you rightly mentioned, he wanted to see a full revolution in the IT sector. I had the opportunity to work with him in the last couple of months. In fact, we missed when I went up to Ottawa the last 3 weeks ago. We were supposed to be at a meeting, but we missed because he went down to New York and asked that we continue the meeting. Yes, he has embraced that concept, and we would definitely have to see it on. He did all to infuse people's life. He lightened up their life and enlightened their spirit. And that is testament to the when we see so many people lining the streets waiting to pay their last respect. And I am sure that you would embrace the whole opportunity to carry on his legacy, as you have pointed out. And Mr. Singh, you may have some last.
Yes, I just want to thank you, Sylvester. So I'm just how is the family dealing with this? Are they getting any stronger through it?
When Mike died, it had Mike being the first member, first son, because Mike really was like the head of the family. And when he died, I thought, you know, it would take us a long time to recover. We recovered up to a point. I think it was just, I just don't think we will recover. You know, it will take us a long, long time, 20 years at least. Rosie was such a huge figure, politically and otherwise. I don't know how, as a family, we can recover, because when you look after Rosie, to be brutally honest, there's not much else. I mean, it's a big family, but there are not many stars in it. Not in Rosie's class, anyway.
How is his mother handling it?
Well, Granny has this sort of superstition that you should not attend your children's funeral. But I think for some reason, she didn't go to Arbedee's funeral. Sorry, she didn't go to Mike's funeral, her son. But for some reason, she's going to Rose's funeral. I'm not sure why, because apparently if you go to your children's funeral, they'll all pop off one after the other. Well, we don't need that right now. But for some reason, she's going to the funeral. Her pressure was up, and, you know, we've been testing all the time. She really, it's been hard on her, really. She's been very quiet, but you can tell, looking at her face, she looks very withdrawn, and and serene and quiet, and you know there's a lot building up and simmering underneath, you know.
You know, Sean, we can talk about the loss of the Prime Minister on a national level, international level, political, but it is said that the loss